behalf of our Board of Education, welcome. Thank you for giving up an evening. I promise I'm not going to spend 3 hours, but we're going to devote, hopefully an hour or less to just bring you up to speed on lots of exciting things. And truly, I'm very, very excited to be able to share and to celebrate all of the great things that we have going on in our school district, and then what we get to look forward to. And what I get very, very excited about is when we continuously strive to improve all that we are and all that we do for our students by improving environments, by improving conditions, by improving and raising expectations and standards, and partnering with all of our families and our businesses and community leaders. Could not expect anything less, or anything more. It's just fantastic to be able to serve and work here. The other thing that we always strive to do is to stretch our dollars. So we always want to do what's best educationally, and we want to do all that we can to stretch dollars and be good stewards to all of our community members and to our taxpaying citizens. I'd love to just give a few quick introductions here tonight, and we have two of our Board of Education members, Mrs. Kaschek, our board president, and Mrs. Amy Berger, one of our Board of Education members. So thank you so much for representing our board. We've also got, I believe, several members of our administrative team. So team members, would you please raise your hands? Members of our administrative team, and there you are, mostly in the back, and a few right here in the front. Mr. Phillips, our district treasurer, is up here, and so I thank you. I thank our members of our team and our treasurer for being here as well. I believe that if you have, and this is Mrs. Green, Sally Green, one of our Board of Education members. If anybody has children in grades pre-K through 3 or in toddlers, we do have childcare in our learning center. And then, of course, if you heard my announcement, I see some older students in the room, and that makes me happy because I did extend an invitation to our students in grades 4 through 12 to be a part of this. And the purpose for that is I think it's good for our young people to understand, or at least gain a better understanding of what's happening in our schools and how we operate and what we're striving to do and what we're striving to be. A few housekeeping things and some instructions. On your table, hopefully there should be a pen or pencil there for you, and there's an index card. Feel free to pass out those index cards. The purpose of the index cards is to give you the opportunity. If you've got a question or questions, please jot those questions down as I'm presenting, because we've got a room this big with this many people, I'm not going to entertain questions as I'm presenting. But if you have a question, please jot that down, and then at the end, I'll ask members of our administrative team to pick those up, and then what we'll do is we'll give an opportunity for Q&A at the end, and we'll take a look at those questions and see if there are themes so that we're not repeating ourselves over and over and over again, okay? And hopefully during the presentation, you'll see that we've done our best to try to address frequently asked questions or questions that we would anticipate, so we'll do that. You also have a response and feedback card. I would ask, here's my request. I'm asking for every person in the room, especially every adult, please, and students too, to take the opportunity and complete that form. You don't have to put your name or contact information at the bottom, but I'd be happy to follow up with you if you would like me to. But your feedback is important. So please be sure to complete that. I will collect all of those. Our administrative team and I will review all of those forms, and your feedback is critical to the success as we move forward. Okay, so we will dive into the state of the schools and our district update. Our objectives within this time that we have together is to share a facility update and to also take a look at sharing the vision and purpose of a district-wide start and end time, as well as implementing a single route transportation system. We'll take a look at the key points for that and the benefits of that, as well as frequently asked questions, and also seek your feedback. All right, so that's what we want to accomplish during this time. Starting off with facilities, I know that these buildings look familiar to you. I just, for space's sake, I put two on each slide, and I did organize the pictures in order of age of facility. So starting at the top, we are now sitting in our Tusky Valley Middle School. You can see that our middle school currently houses grades 5 through 8. We currently have 416 students here at our middle school. It was finished in 1996, so it's around 20, 21 years old. So this building is around 20, 21 years old. Our high school is the next youngest building and obviously houses grades 9 through 12 with 467 students, and that does include Buckeye Career Center. So if you removed students that are attending Buckeye Career Center or College Credit Plus or post-secondary options, obviously that number would be less. The building was finished in 1960, so our high school is 57 years old. Next is our primary school, located in Mineral City. Of course, our primary school houses preschool, kindergarten, and first grade. Right now, we have 216 students in our primary school. It was built in 1935. There was an addition onto that building, and I don't have that year in my memory, but the original structure is 82 years old. And then our intermediate school is 90 years old, is housing grades 2, 3, and 4, currently with 318 students, and it was finished in 1927. Our intermediate school did have, I believe, two additions, if I recall correctly, original Bolivar Elementary School. So I wanted to just give a picture of our existing facilities, and then what we want to take a look at is potential opportunities. Now, here's my question to our group tonight. Raise your hand if you have seen any kind of signage pop up here recently, really within the last 2 weeks. Have you seen those signs? It says Rover Pipeline access here, arrows here and there. And I don't know about you, but I noticed it just over a weekend. I mean, they just popped up out of nowhere. And then I captured this picture. I know it's got to be very, very fuzzy for those of you clear in the back, but this picture is off of, I believe, Sherman Church Road, just north of our intermediate school. And you'll see those kinds of areas where the work has already begun. The path is being cleared. And you may be wondering, well, okay, Ms. Murphy, you were talking about facilities, and all of a sudden you jumped to this Rover pipeline. What on earth is the connection? Here's the connection. Mr. Phillips, our treasurer, has been talking with me and with our Board of Education for really about the past 2 years and saying, Mark, let's pay close attention to this. And I'm thinking, Rover Pipeline, what does this have to do with Tusky Valley Local Schools? Here's the key. And you will hear me use words tonight like potential, potential opportunity, probable, likely. You will not hear from me because I cannot guarantee, promise, set in stone, I cannot go there. Does that make sense? So what I can do is talk about an opportunity and where we can hopefully be prepared in the event that there is an opportunity. So preparation plus opportunity hopefully equals success. The Rover Pipeline is a large pipeline that is running from the southeastern section of Ohio and West Virginia area and travels through Ohio and on up through to Canada, correct? If you know anything, I know that there are folks that know much, much more about the Rover Pipeline than I do, but this is a very large pipeline that is parallel lines. Large pipes, parallel lines, I believe like 41 inches in diameter, and this pipeline is going to be carrying billions of cubic feet of natural gas every day. Does that sound correct, Mr. Downey? Okay, so what does that mean for Tusky Valley? Where the Rover Pipeline passes through Tuscarawas County, 100% of the Rover Pipeline travels through the boundaries of Tuscarawas Valley Local School District. What does that mean? That means that there is potential that our school district, through the county, could benefit from tax utility or revenue off of the taxes from the Rover Pipeline. What does that mean? Well, that means we need to be prepared. In the event that that is true and it could happen for us, we want to be ready and we want to be able to be strategic with what we would potentially do with that revenue. So, there's our potential opportunity. I also captured this picture. There's an example of a pipe. This is as I was driving, by the way. I did have to stop and take the picture. I didn't keep driving. But this is at the sharp curve there where it used to be Hayes Pest Control. It's now the motocross detailing place. And you can see the Zor sign. And there was that semi hauling that one enormous pipe. And I thought, there it is. I've got to capture this picture. I apologize that my screen is being cut off here. The right side, if there's anybody that can help with that, that would be wonderful. If not, we'll just adjust. This icon on the upper right-hand side represents the Ohio Facilities Construction Commission. Now, for those of us that have been a part of our Tuscarawas Valley local community for several years, that you may recall that back in 2008, 2009, our school district partnered with the Ohio Facilities Construction Commission to do a facilities project. And at that time, but that required a bond issue, okay? And the bond issue was defeated. In 2008, the plan that we were presenting to our community, that we were asking our community to vote on, was a new high school, a new elementary school on this campus, and renovations to this existing middle school to bring it up to standard. That bond issue failed in 2008, and then we tried a segmented approach just for one new elementary school to combine K through 4 all at one campus right here, and that was the only thing we were reaching for in May of 2009. That also was a failed bond issue attempt. At that time, the state was willing to pay 45% of the total cost of the project. The remaining 55% needed to be paid by whom? Right now, and again, I apologize, but right now, the way our district is ranked and according to our equity ranking, Tuscarawas Valley Local Schools right now currently sits at 40% would be funded by the state of Ohio through the Facilities Construction Commission, and the remaining 60%, if we were pursuing a bond issue, would be paid by whom? Right. I will tell you that our Board of Education and Mr. Phillips, Treasurer, and I have zero intention of pursuing a bond issue.
Yay!
I would thank you. We would not even have a conversation about it. I'll just stop there. It's not the right thing to do. However, if our school district could potentially benefit from revenue from the Rover pipeline through tax utilities that we can strategically target, that revenue could serve as the local share. Please nod your head yes if you understand that. That means we could potentially move forward and address facility needs for our entire district, whatever that may look like, without burdening or placing an additional tax in any form to our citizens. Okay? So when I say potential opportunity, that's what that means. All right? So now do you understand the connection between our facilities and the Rover pipeline? Okay, great. So we just, in a nutshell, we want to be prepared. So what does that mean? Let me give you an example. Here is, and again, I know if you're sitting in the back, this is very difficult to read or see, but here is the red. This is Tuscarawas County, and you can see where the Rover pipeline is coming up through the northeastern section of Tuscarawas County. Notice too, and most of you know this, our school district also extends a little bit up into Stark County. So again, where the Rover pipeline is passing through Tuscarawas County, it is 100% going through the boundaries of Tusky Valley Local Schools. Not necessarily, it's not going through the property of Tusky Valley. You're sitting on the property of Tusky Valley. You understand. It's going through the boundaries. And you can see the path. Okay? So I wanted to just show a quick visual of what that looked like. So what is our commitment to our facilities and in anticipation with the Rover pipeline? Well, obviously, number one, our goal is always, always, always to provide the best education and best educational opportunities, learning opportunities for our children. That is the ultimate goal. Premier education in the most cost-effective manner. And you, for those of you who know me, and you've heard me say this before, and our administrative team believes in it deeply, our focus is always on education first. And finances second. And it's not that we don't care about finances. We care deeply about finances. But if we started to make every decision based on the dollar only, we would quickly get things out of whack, right? So we want to keep our priorities as education first in the most cost-effective manner. And our commitment is to recognize the potential impact of the Rover pipeline and what that could mean for our school district. We also are planning to partner, actually we have already partnered. Our Board of Education at its most recent meeting approved a resolution to begin the active planning process with the Ohio Facilities Construction Commission. The beauty of that is it does not commit our school district or our Board of Education to anything, but it does arm us and prepare us by they will provide a complete comprehensive assessment of our facilities, including enrollment as it stands, enrollment projections for about 10 years out, and just provides a lot of important detail regarding our facilities back to us as a school district. We are also in the process, our Board of Education is in the process of interviewing and selecting an architect. And you may think, my goodness, Mr. Murphy, what on earth? I mean, you're just talking about a Rover pipeline and now we need to secure an architect. The Facilities Commission, Ohio Facilities Commission, works in partnership and in tandem with an architect that the Board of Education chooses. So we are in the process of interviewing to select an architect to work alongside the Facilities Commission to provide feedback to our district and provide work in tandem for that assessment. They together then will investigate and explore the best options for our school district and present those options to us. And then, as a district and as a community, I trust that we are able to address those facility needs according to whatever that best option may be. Now, if someone were to ask me right now, Mr. Murphy, so what's the plan? What are we going to build? I have no idea. Absolutely not. There is no commitment. And you know, what I have to do, and I've shared this with our board, I've shared this with my wife, I've shared this with our administrative team and with Mr. Phillips, I have to give up every preconceived notion that I have had in my head about what facilities could be. Because what does Mark Murphy still have in his head? I'm still thinking back to 2008 and 2009. I have to get rid of that. I have to get rid of that. Why? And I'll explain a few things here in a little bit that will provide some evidence to this. Our enrollment now, as a school district, is not what our enrollment was 12 years ago, or 15 years ago, or even 9 years ago when we were pursuing new facilities. Our enrollment is less. Our enrollment has dropped. Now, it's not drastic, but there has been a slight decline every year in our student enrollment. You may ask, well, why is that? I have no idea. But I have some speculations. Our population is aging. We have less younger people living in our district and moving into the district. If you are into realty, you'll notice that in our school district, for families that are looking to move in and they're looking for a home, let's say, in the $150,000 range, they may not find many, depending on where they're looking. They may find homes in the $250,000 and $300,000 range, and they may find homes in the $100,000 or less range. But for most families today, right now, according to what realtors are sharing with me, many of them are looking for homes within that 150, 175 range. And it's not that there aren't any, but they're not coming in. There's also less infants being born. Couples are waiting longer to have children. There's just lots of factors. What's interesting, and I'll just give you a tidbit of history here. When I started in 2005, there was already an enrollment projection done for our school district. When I started in 2005, we had a little bit less than 1,700 students K through 12. A little less than 1,700 students. Right now, we have a little bit more than 1,400 students. Guess what? That enrollment projection that I looked at in 2005 that said in 2014, 2015, 2016, enrollment will be around mid-1400s. Then I said, that has got to be wrong. There's no way. That's just false. There's no way that can be accurate. It's right on. It's amazing how they do that. I don't know how it happens. There's just some history about our enrollment, and we've got to just be looking at things differently. I don't want to come in with a preconceived notion. This needs to be whatever happens. If we're able to move forward with something like this, it will be a community-driven, community-heavy involvement of what the community feels is important and appropriate as we receive guidance from the Ohio Facilities Commission and the architect. Because guess what? They're the ones that do this for a living. That's what they do. We're the educators. I'm the educator. I'm not the architect or the designer. All right, so that's on the facilities perspective. Now as we transition into thinking about a district-wide start and end time, as well as redesigning our transportation system, here are some facts and just current operations. So we're now gonna move into the transportation department. I love this picture. This was taken a couple years ago during bus driver appreciation, and it was right out here in front of our middle school, and we had all of our kids exit the building. It was at dismissal time, but we had all of the kids go out and greet our bus drivers and wave to them and shower them with accolades. It was a neat time. Here's our current transportation operations. Now note, this is based on our existing double route system. When I say double route, what I mean by that is when our buses leave our bus garage in the morning, they go out, they pick up middle school and high school students, grades 5 through 12. They complete those runs throughout 95 square miles of our school district. They bring those students back to middle school and high school. Then they go out and they conduct the elementary run. And they bring the elementary students back to the elementaries and do the corresponding shuttle as necessary. We currently operate 18 regular route school buses with 18 school bus drivers, okay? We currently travel over 1,500 miles per day. And keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, this is just day-to-day operations. This does not include field trips. This does not include any kind of extracurricular activity or travel regarding sports, athletics, band, whatever the activity or the group may be. So over 1,500 miles, we currently haul about 950 students on our school buses. You can see the cost per day at a little around $6,000. And keep in mind, the cost that we have here is fiscal year 2016. So this financial data that we have is actually outdated. It's a year old. So you can imagine that the expenses are higher, right? So our cost per year exceeds $1 million out of our general fund, out of our annual operating budget, to run those 18 buses over 95 square miles, traveling 1,500 miles per day. Now, just to keep it in perspective, because I'm thinking, well, 1,500 miles, that's probably not too bad for 18 buses, right? 1,500 miles, and those of you who travel or know your geography really well, I mean, that's the equivalent of leaving from here. Let's say we all get in our cars, we get on the bus, and we're going to travel from here beyond Myrtle Beach and back every day. Or even more accurately, it'd be traveling from here to Portland, Maine, and back every day, not including trips, not including field trips. So what that means is that $1 million is representing about 7.5%, almost 8% of our total operating budget. Keep in mind that this is what we've been doing, this is the model that we have been following, and it works. It's been effective, it's not efficient. And you may say, well, why is that? Well, again, there are less students enrolled in our district, number one. And then secondly, there are less students riding our school buses. Now again, if you were to ask me, Mr. Murphy, why is that? Why are there only 950 students riding the bus when there are over 1,400 students enrolled? Well, here's Mark Murphy's speculation. Number one, the majority of our juniors and seniors do what? They drive. Now, I don't know about all of us in the room, but when I grew up, that was not something that was an automatic for me. It just wasn't. Things are different. Today, interestingly, just for fun, I drove through our student parking lot. What did I find? 101 vehicles in the student parking lot. Very nice vehicles sometimes. It's incredible, and that's wonderful, but that's the reality. It's the reality, okay? The other thing is, we notice, and if you travel in and around our district, again, if you were to ask me why, I don't know. There's lots of factors. Maybe, you know, today we want to be convenient. It's about convenience. It's about spending more time with our children. So I'm going to drive them to school. I don't want to have to wait for the bus. I don't want to have to do anything with the bus for whatever reason. So I'm going to drive, whatever that means. And that's okay. It just is. But if we are hauling less and less students on our school buses, and we are traveling 1,500 miles a day, over 95 to 100 square miles a day, just because that's the way we've always done it, is that the most efficient model? It's not. Okay. So where would we go with this? So our primary goal, again, is providing the best education possible in the most cost-effective manner. So our vision for 2017 and 18 is to implement a common start and end time across our entire district for all schools, which would be 8 a.m. start time, 3 p.m. end time. We would obviously revise our routes, and here's the interesting thing. We would revise our routes based on actual ridership versus based on all students enrolled. Right now, and this is no fault of any of our folks, it's just what we do, and the software allows it to do it this way. We basically design our routes based on students enrolled in the district. Now, on the surface, that makes sense, right? But what happens is, I'm designing a route, and I've got a whole bunch of students that may or may not ride, but I designed that route that way. What we need to do is design our routes according to ridership, and that's why we did that survey. For those of us that are parents, you may remember a survey that came home before Christmas, actually. We were asking, what is your children's need, or what is your family's need? Does your child or children regularly ride the school bus, occasionally ride, or never ride? It's amazing, the stack of never ride and occasional regular. Well, what we would do then is, and we've already done it, we have all of that information so far for all of our existing kindergarten through grade 11 students who will now be first through seniors. What we need to do is capture that information for kindergartners. Our vision to third bullet point here is to increase our instruction time for all K through 4. So at our primary intermediate school, our goal through a common start and end time is to increase teaching time and learning time at our elementary schools. We would be able to increase our time by about 40 to 45 minutes every single day. Now, the educator in me and the teachers in our schools at the primary and intermediate school, I trust, are loving that, because here's, again, if you're familiar with our district and you're familiar with our processes, what's happening now at the end of every day at primary and intermediate? Our teachers and our staff and our principals are basically managing bus dismissal for about 40 to 45 plus minutes. Am I right, Mrs. Flickinger, Mrs. Clements? So that is not the best use of our time. It is what it is, but knowing that and knowing what we know, it's not the best use of our time. We want to maximize that and improve and increase instruction time. Our goal is also to increase safety, simplify and streamline our operations using a common sense approach, and support our families. In doing all of those things, we are then increasing our operating efficiency, stretching our school resources and our community's dollars. Now, how would that look? And if you're sitting up front, you can see this, and if you're in the back, probably not so much. In a nutshell, what I've shown are, you see the four buildings, and five being Warren Township Community Center on the lower right-hand side. you'll see that there are eight icons of eight school buses up around Bolivar. What that means is our goal would be to take, and you'll see 16 buses in the district. Two buses, again, that's cut off, and I'm so sorry. This worked last Friday. I don't understand why it's not working now. But two buses are off to the side, and I'll explain that in a second. But let's take intermediate school, Bolivar, for instance. When our buses leave the bus garage in the morning, under this model, under this proposed plan, our buses will go, eight buses of our fleet will go to the Bolivar-Wilkshire Hills area. Why? Because that's the greatest density in terms of population. That's where we need eight buses to go to that area. Those eight buses will pick up kindergarten through grade 12 students, if we have any juniors or seniors riding. They would pick up those kids K through 12. They would then bring those students K through 12, those eight buses would arrive at our intermediate school at 7:25. They would hold those students on those buses for a few moments, and at about 7:30, doors open on those buses. Students on those eight buses have an option. They'll either get off that bus because this is the school where they go to. I'm a second, third, or fourth grader, so I go to intermediate school. Or they'll remain on that bus because that bus is going to transfer them or shuttle them, which is what we do now, shuttle them to their designated school. Okay? So you can see that's just an example of how that works by area, you know, using Bolivar as an example. Let me take New Cumberland area as an example, our southeastern section of our school district. Notice that there are only three buses covering that area, but again, that's because of density. So those three buses would go out from the bus garage, go to the New Cumberland area, pick up K through 12 students. They would arrive, those three buses would arrive simultaneously at New Cumberland at 7:25. Hold the students at 7:30, they open the doors. Now, no students are going into the community center, right? But they will get on, they will either remain on that bus, or they'll get on a bus that will go to Bolivar, a bus that will go to Mineral City, or a bus that will come here to the middle school and high school complex. And buses would leave at 7:35. You may be thinking, okay, Ms. Murphy, well, what if I've got, what if I live in New Cumberland and I've got, you know, a child that goes to primary school and intermediate school? And I don't want them to ride the bus, can I just take them to the New Cumberland Community Center and then the bus shuttle them? Yes, that's what we do now. So we would maintain that same kind of service. None of our parents ever need to feel like they need to drive from building to building to building unless they just desire to do that. We provide the service. So here's the plan, and I basically walked you through that, but if you'd like to see it in writing, that's what that looks like. We've talked about the first bullet points here. When the buses pull out at 7:35 from their home base locations, then they travel to the designated schools, and they would arrive by 7:50. So at 7:50, all children that are riding buses will be to their designated buildings. Start time, 8 a.m. In the afternoon, basically, we reverse all of that. So the end time, the end of the day, would be 3 p.m. Our buses would depart at 3:05 from the designated school, arrive at each of the home schools, which is, when I say home school, that's your area. We're based on your residence, right? So they would arrive to each of our home schools by 3:20, our home schools being Bolivar, Mineral City, New Cumberland, and our middle school and high school. Students then, at 3:20, remain on that bus. They have options. They're either going to remain on that bus because that bus is going to take them home, or they'll transfer to another bus to be transported home, or they'll exit the bus as a walker and be picked up like they normally are now. Buses would then depart from the home school locations at 3:25 to transport students home. So that's the transportation proposal in a nutshell in terms of how it would work, the details of that. But if I were to say, I mean, most simply, I would put my father hat on, like as a dad with two children in our school district. What's happening right now is, unless, you know, because I work here, oftentimes our daughters, I'm driving her, unless I've got early morning commitments and that kind of thing. But the opportunity exists for both of the children to get on the bus, even if they were attending different schools, both of the children would get on the bus at the same time. Siblings getting on the bus at the same time. What's happening in the Murphys, and I don't know if it happens with you, but here's kind of what it looks like in the Murphy household. 6:35 is the bus pickup time, which means if I'm following the rules, our daughter needs to be down at the bus stop at 6:30, right? It's always 5 minutes before. That's the request. So prior to 6:30, you can imagine, it's a lot of rushing around, lunches, backpack, get everything ready, hustle, hustle, come on, get going, do your hair, etc. Okay, and then get to the bus stop, 6:30, okay, great. But there's still one at the house. So as soon as I get that one on the bus, then I go, okay, do it again. There's a moment of a pause, and then if you're the mom, or you're the dad that's the caregiver, or the grandparent, and if you've got siblings, you're doing it all over again, between the middle school and elementary. This is all children getting on the bus at the same time. I promise you, just like we have been, we would get your children to their designated school very simply. Here's the other beautiful thing about this plan. Right now, if your children ride the bus, they may have a different bus number and bus driver from the morning to the afternoon. Under this model, it simplifies. Our children will be looking at the same bus number and the same bus driver for both morning and afternoon. Now, there may be a different shuttle driver in the middle if they need to be shuttled to another designated school. So what does that comparison look like in terms of operations? Well, we would still need and maintain 18 buses and 18 routes, 18 drivers. We would go from 1,500 miles a day to about 850 miles a day. We will assume that the students that are riding would remain the same. That's just an assumption. At around 950. What does that do? We're very conservatively, we are looking at an approximate savings of $100,000 annually by shifting to this different model. Now, you can probably guess as to where the greatest amount of savings would be, right? Going from 1,500 miles to 850 miles. Now, keep in mind, we're not talking about transporting 18 Prius. Is it a Prius? You know, the little car that probably gets about 30 miles to the gallon? We're not talking about 18 of those running 1,500 miles. We're talking about a school bus. So the greatest amount of savings comes from fuel, less fuel consumption, less wear and tear on the bus, all of those kinds of things. So some key points of going with the proposed start and end time of 8 a.m., common district-wide start and end time, 8 a.m., 3 p.m., as well as implementing a single-route transportation system versus the existing double-route system. First of all, it's improved safety, and I mentioned this before. Some of these points may be recurring, but we've got all of our siblings boarding, riding, and being dropped together. That is key. If you're a parent and you've got an older child and a younger child, and right now you're trying to be responsible for, oh my goodness, well my older one is getting home first, and then there's this wall, and then my younger one's coming home, and you've got to manage that and figure out how you want that to work. Older students are also available to help our younger children on that bus, especially during evacuations. Now, I know we don't do that. We practice by law. We have to do evacuations on our school bus. Now, imagine being the school bus driver, and you're currently hauling a load of kindergarten and first graders from the intermediate school over to the primary school, and you need to do that bus evacuation. By law, the bus driver has to stay in his or her seat, buckled in, ignition turned off, parking brake pulled, and then the instruction is given, evacuate out the front and evacuate out the rear. Now, I don't know about you, but trying to watch kindergarten and first graders by themselves exit the rear of the school bus is probably not the safest thing to do, and that's just tough. But anyways, we increase safety because we've got our older students riding the bus. In inclement weather, our buses then would be out on the roads once versus twice, if it's once in the morning versus twice in the morning, or once in the afternoon versus twice, because right now Our buses go out and they cover those 95 square miles 4 times a day. This model would allow us to send our buses out and they would cover our 95 square miles 2 times per day. The increased convenience and simplicity for our parents and students, I mentioned this before, it's one family pickup and drop-off time versus a staggered time, that start and end time. That, we believe that that just has got to add some greater convenience and simplicity, at least for the majority of our parents and families. And I mentioned this before, the morning and afternoon bus driver and bus number would be the same. We also have greater convenience when there's a 2-hour delay or an early dismissal. For instance, what does that mean? Right now, when I and other superintendents and Mr. Spillman, our transportation supervisor, when we're up at 4 a.m. or driving the roads and conferring with each other, and I have to make a decision about whether we're closing school or delaying school by 5 a.m. or by 5:10 at the latest, it makes sense to me that when I'm looking at radar and when I'm looking at the roads and consulting with other folks, it makes sense if I'm going to call a 2-hour delay, it makes perfect sense that we're moving our start time for middle school and high school from 7:30 to 9:30 for lots of reasons. It's daylight now. Oftentimes when the sun hits, the sun, snow begins to melt, the salt begins to activate, all those kinds of things. What I struggle with as the superintendent and the educator in me and the brilliant principal in me is, oh my goodness, okay, so the superintendent is making this determination at 5 a.m. A 2-hour delay for elementary school going from 9 a.m. means a start time of 11 a.m. What happens as soon as we get our students to school at 11 a.m.? We feed them. It's not the most productive use of our day. However, if we have a common district-wide start time of 8 a.m. and I'm making that determination, probably not as early as 5, then we're saying that start time district-wide will be 10 a.m. That's much more reasonable. That makes a lot more sense. It does provide greater, another piece here. For those families that do travel a lot for extracurricular activities, what happens now is if I've got a middle school or high school student that's involved in athletics, oftentimes I'm calling the elementary schools or the secretaries and say, you know what, I need to pick up my elementary child because I need to rush and do. Well, now everybody's going to be dismissing at the same time. That should make things a little bit simpler for our parents and families. We talked about increasing our instruction time for educators. For K through 4, it's increasing that time by about 40 to 45 minutes every day. The other thing is improved use of time for educators. It does give the opportunity, not that it has to be used this way every single day, but at the discretion of our building principals and our grade level teams, those teams have the potential of getting together, if they want, every day from about 7:35 to 8 a.m. as that's coordinated by the building principal. And, I'm sure that there would be teachers on duty and those kinds of things, so you have to work around that, but the opportunity does exist. We've talked about the improved operational efficiencies, scheduling our buses on the roads 2 times per day versus 4 times a day. The other key is this. We are going to better maximize, this is key, ladies and gentlemen, better maximize the capacity of our school buses. Now, does anyone know, other than our team members, does anyone know how many students, by law, the school bus, a typical standard school bus, is able to hold? Any guesses? Throw it out. 55? More?
64.
64? More? 72. 72 is the magic answer. Now, that's the assumption that there's 3 per seat. That's not what we're suggesting. But I'll tell you this, and I mean this with the utmost respect of our school bus drivers and the utmost respect of our parents and families and our employees of our school district. It makes me sigh. Today, I told Mr. Phillips this afternoon, at the end of the day, our buses were loaded. Middle school students had already been on the bus. High school, now we're waiting over at the high school. And I counted 6 to 8 students on a school bus. When that school bus, by law, has the capacity of holding 72, I'm not advocating that we put 3 to a seat on every bus. That's not what we're asking. We don't have enough kids enrolled to fill all of those seats. But I'd be thrilled if we had 40 kids on the bus, 30 kids on the bus. That's being efficient, and that's being wise with our taxpayers' dollars. That's changing and adjusting due to what the circumstances that we're in. The recognizing the savings, there is significant savings due to the reduced mileage, fuel consumption, wear and tear, decreasing our maintenance costs, also hopefully then extending the life of our school buses. That would be key. You want to make your equipment last as long as you possibly can. So let's jump into some frequently asked questions and some considerations. What will be the new district-wide start and end time? We covered that earlier. Beginning with the 17-18 school year, we would propose that we start the district-wide would be 8 a.m. start time, and 3 p.m. would be the dismissal time at the end of the day. Our first day of this plan would be August 23rd. First day of school is when, I know we just entered the fourth grading period, and here we are talking about the first day of school, but Wednesday, August 23rd, 2017 is the first day of school. You may be curious, well, what other districts, Mr. Murphy, follow this plan? Is there anybody else? I mean, does Tusky Valley have to be, you know, go out on the edge here and do this new thing? Indian Valley schools, Claymont local schools, and Newcomers Town schools all currently operate with this model. And all of them, in my studies and conversations with those folks, with those leaders and those transportation folks, confirm that their system is effective, and it's efficient, and it's been helpful. Will the bus routes be shorter or longer than they are now? So for instance, for bus riders, let's talk about students. Will the bus ride be longer or shorter? Well, really the bus route, and for a student, that ride time would be very similar to what it is currently. Again, we'd be designing the routes based on who says, I need the bus. I ride the bus regularly, or Mr. Murphy, I ride the bus occasionally. We would not be putting in the system those students or those families that say, Mr. Murphy, don't ever count me to ride the bus. Our children will never ride the bus, never ever. That may be fine, but you and I both know your situation may change. Or let's say you're a parent of a junior and senior who does drive himself or herself to school, and for whatever reason their privileges are revoked by you, and you say, now they're on the bus. Great, we'll add them on. It's not a problem. We will make that adjustment. Oh, this is a big key. Right now, if you were in my world or sitting in to see what I see, our bus drivers and our teachers see this, and our principals see this, and our drivers know it. They sit a lot. Right now, we pay them to sit a lot, and that's no disrespect to them, but we pay them for layover. So when our buses are done dismissing or dropping off our children in middle school and high school by 7:20 at the latest, and they don't need to leave the bus garage until, at the latest, 10 till 8, to go start their elementary run. That's about a half hour every single day of time that's called layover. So we would reduce that layover time, get the most out of our bus drivers, our driver time, our employees, as well as the capacity of our school buses. What will be the official teacher workday? Well, a teacher workday remains at 7.5 hours. We would officially make that teacher workday 7:35 a.m. to 3:05 p.m. There's always flexibility with that. From my perspective, many of our teachers, the majority of our teachers, are not stuck. They don't think like, oh, I punch in 7.5 hours and I'm done. That's not how education works. That's not how teachers think. But we have to have an official. The principals then can designate, you know what, I need this person to start 15 minutes earlier. They will end their day 15 minutes earlier, and I can make those arrangements. Here's a key one. You know, I'm concerned about my kindergartner, let's say. Some of you are enrolling your kindergartners this year for the 17-18 school year. You may say to me, Mr. Murphy, I'm really concerned about my kindergarten child who's now in the learning center being with childcare, riding the bus with older students, especially, you know, riding the bus with seniors. Well, here's what we would say to that. First of all of the area districts that I mentioned, because this was a critical question that our team posed to their teams. And their response was, all of those districts that do that indicate they do not have any concerns. Mr. Wentworth from Indian Valley says, Mr. Murphy, in my entire time as superintendent, I have not had one phone call or concern about a younger child with an older child or vice versa. I know that that's a real concern, but that's what we've learned from them. The other thing that they share with us is that When you have older students that are on the bus with younger siblings and other younger children, those older kids begin to serve as role models. Why? Because that's what we expect them to do. And they serve as mentors, and they start helping. And especially when you've got, if you have multiple children, you have your siblings on the bus. You're not separating your children from morning to, you know, from two, the staggered time. They're boarding and riding that bus together. The other point is, again, kind of alluding to what I mentioned earlier with 101 student vehicles in the student parking lot at the high school, most of our juniors and seniors do not ride the bus. And although on a very small scale, our district already currently transports K-12 children together. We pick up our Central Catholic Elementary School children, and they ride they're elementary children, but they're riding our middle school and high school route. And then we shuttle them to the Central Catholic Elementary School. And you may recall, for those of us that were in the district back 3 years ago, 13-14 school year, when we were in financial straits and we eliminated high school transportation for an entire semester, we were transporting pre-K through 8 at one time. And we had a pre-K to 8 common start and end time. And it worked out exceptionally well. In fact, we had great feedback from both educators and parents regarding that. Now, it wasn't great for high school students that depended on the school bus. How will the new schedule affect after-school or extracurricular activities? There would be no negative or adverse impact on after-school commitments or extracurriculars. In fact, by transferring, this is interesting how all of this is happening, and this is not because of me or any intentional planning, but we are transferring from the Principal's Athletic Conference, the PAC-7, to the Intervalley Conference, the IVC. That has some benefits to it. Number one, we're traveling more locally. We're not traveling as far as what we were traveling under the PAC League. So there's lots of benefits to that. And if I recall correctly, our middle school, confirmed for this, Mrs. Knowles, our middle school athletes would not be leaving as early. They would be departing from our schools a little bit later. What about transportation for students attending Buckeye Career Center or Tusscarawas Central Catholic, whether that be elementary or high school? We would continue to provide that transportation service for them. Here's what will happen, though. Right now, those Buckeye Career Center students or Central Catholic students, they get on their regular route, they come into the high school, and then they ride the Buckeye bus, bus 8, from here, from the high school to Buckeye Career Center. Remember those two buses that I had sitting on the outliers over here on that one page? Those two buses, we already know right now, we know by name, by address, which students that plan to attend Buckeye Career Center next year, which students need the bus, and they're asking for the bus. Now again, right now, we're just plugging them in because they're enrolled. We would then send those two buses out to literally, we know which students have said, Mr. Murphy, I would like the bus, I'm a Buckeye student, I would like the bus to pick me up at my home. We also know which students have said, Mr. Murphy, I've got a car, and I'm going to be driving to the student parking lot, and I'd like to ride the Buckeye bus from the parking lot to Buckeye. And we have others that said, Mr. Murphy, I don't need any school bus transportation. I have a car, or someone else is going to drive me, and I'm driving myself to Buckeye Career Center and back. You don't have to worry about that. So we are planning deliberately to design those routes according to that as well. Will students still be able to get breakfast once they arrive to school? Absolutely, yes. Breakfast will continue to be served. I assure you that Mrs. Flickinger, who is also serves as our intermediate school principal and food services supervisor, will make sure that breakfast is provided to all of our children. And to keep in mind too, all kids will be at their designated buildings under this model if they're riding the bus by 7:50. This last question. Well, if this is so wonderful, why haven't we implemented it earlier? Have you thought that? I have. Here's what's happened. This is something that we have been monitoring for years. In fact, I remember asking Mr. Downing, who was our supervisor several years ago, and I said, Mr. Downing, I'm noticing less and less kids on our school buses. Do you think it would be wise of us to at least investigate implementing a single route transportation system? And his response then was, no, Mark, we couldn't afford it. It would not work unless you're willing to buy another bus and hire another bus driver because our enrollment was higher then. He was right. We would have needed to have purchased another bus and hired another driver to make a single route system work. Our enrollment is different now. And what we do know now, given what we know, acting on this now is being proactive, it is increasing our operating efficiency, and it is stretching our district's resources. Will we continue to provide transportation to and from area preschools? Yes, absolutely. We will continue that. We currently provide transportation to and from All About Children and through the years preschools and daycare providers. This is my last question. How and when will I know if your child, if your parent, and your children ride the bus? How and when will I know what bus my children will ride for next year? We are going to redesign how we do this. Can someone tell me how you currently know when what bus your child will ride?
About a week before school starts, 3 days before school starts, we have to go to the school to look at the door.
The weekend before, typically, this is how we've done it in the past. We firm that up the weekend before school starts, and we post them on the doors, and we make our parents drive all over the place, and you press your noses against the glass to find out, right? And you look, and you're writing all these things down. What we plan to do is to list the approximate, not by name, not by student name, but list those approximate start or pickup times by route on our district website in early August. And then, by August 11th, our goal is that we would send written communication to all of our parents and families that says, your child's approximate pickup time is, your bus number is, and bus number is the same for both morning and afternoon. Okay? So that is, we need to move into the 21st century in terms of posting and communicating with our parents and families about, I see some heads nodding. I apologize for that. But we will improve. Okay, so in summary, here's what we've talked about. We've talked about implementing a common start and end time for the entire district, K through 12, regardless of what building we're in, 8 a.m., 3 p.m. We've talked about revising our routes to accommodate preschool or K through 12 pickup. We would still run our preschools like we do. We pick up preschool children in the morning and we drop them in the afternoon. We would not implement a midday kinder or preschool route. That's not something we don't do that now, and we would not entertain doing that in the future. We would obviously be increasing our teaching and learning time for both primary schools, intermediate, and we've talked about increasing the safety of our kids on the buses, as well as simplifying our operations and supporting our families through that one start or pickup and drop off versus staggered times. We've also talked about and emphasized the increase of operating efficiency and saving our district money. So at this time, what I would ask for you to do, if you have a question that you put down on that index card that has not been addressed, or if you need further clarification. So if you've got an index card with a question that you would like for me or someone from our staff to field, what I would ask is just if I could have some principals maybe meander through, and if you've got a card that you would like to have that question asked, and you don't have to put your name on it, but just hold that card up and our team will get those. We'll quickly look through and see if there's any themes, and then we'll entertain those. The other thing I would ask that you do, and you could start doing this now if you'd like, again, that response feedback form is very, very important. You can either start that now, or you can wait until all questions have been raised, and then we would ask for you to complete those forms, because that feedback is really helpful. Okay, great. We'll go ahead and start. And please note, I mean, I told you about an hour, and we are just a tad over an hour, so you are all welcome to stay, and I want to give you the due time. I'm going to respond to each of these questions, and of course, after that, I will stay as long as we need to stay. If you want to talk with me personally or talk with any of our team members, that would be great. So here are some key questions that have been raised. Would all of the younger children be seated closer to the bus driver? And what bus rules are the schools using that are using the system now? That's a great question. We always, the bus drivers are expected to utilize assigned seats. Now, each of our bus drivers have their own styles. They have their own preferences. That is completely up to them. We trust them to be the professional drivers. They are expected to assign seats. Some drivers will quickly bring, your younger children will be right up front, your older children, you know. But that does not have to be, and there is no set law or set system. We do what makes sense based on the population of children riding the bus, as well as what makes sense for that school bus driver and that kind of thing. Keep in mind too, our school buses are all equipped with sound and audio surveillance. That is very helpful as well. The second question was what bus rules are the schools using that are using the system now? Typically, there's law that we all have to follow, but I would say that Indian Valley, Claymont, and Newcomer's Town, their expectations for student riders is very consistent, if not exactly the same, as what ours is. Okay? Our children know seat on seat, feet on floor, back on back, right? That's keep your hands to yourself, your backpacks are on your lap, that kind of backpacks or instruments and those kind of things, it's on your lap, that kind of thing. How will this affect the bus driver's hours or pay if they only have one route in the morning and afternoon compared to their current routes? It sounds like we are cutting their jobs. When our team met with our school bus drivers last Thursday morning and we went through this exact presentation with our school bus drivers, here's what happened in the room. First of all, great transportation department. And those bus drivers, when they realized that yes, their hours, see, our bus drivers are guaranteed, you're gonna get some insight tonight. Our bus drivers are guaranteed 4.5 hours, even if their route is exactly 4.5 hours, or is tad less, or tad more, or whatever. They're guaranteed 4.5 hours by negotiated agreement. Most of our bus routes, as they stand today, range from 5 hours to 5.25 hours to 5.75 hours. More than likely, what this model would do is put most of those 18 drivers at or slightly above the 4.5 hour guarantee. So when I mentioned to you that if we are paying bus drivers, it is about maximizing bus drivers and employability as well as maximizing the capacity of our school buses. All right? No one is losing their job. In our school district, like most school districts, our school bus drivers who work 4.5 hours have full benefits. Most of our drivers probably work for the insurance. I'm just being very honest with you. If you're asking the question, I will be very honest with you. Okay? So no one is losing their job. Hours may be slightly reduced. Our drivers overall, when we made this presentation, driver, we did not have any complaints, did we? We did not have any complaints. We had a few questions, and then it was a matter of, well, Mr. Murphy, doesn't research show that by moving the middle school and high school time back by a half hour, by whatever, that we would get better grades from those kids? That's what our drivers were thinking. Other districts doing the district-wide start and end time of 8 and 3, are they doing it earlier or later? Those districts, the Newcomer's Town, Indian Valley, and Claymont, are all about 8 a.m. and 3 p.m. If they're not 8 a.m. and 3 p.m., it's just a hair on either side, all of those districts that are doing that. Does this plan negatively affect bus drivers? We talked about that. No, not really. What is the earliest pickup time? Great question. What is the earliest pickup time? Well, right now, our earliest pickup time for all of our buses probably starts around 6:05, 6:10, 6:15. My instruction to Mr. Spillman, our transportation supervisor, you have to think with me on this. Think backwards. Remember, we're asking all of our buses to arrive at the home base school at what time? 7:25. At 7:30, some of those kids are going to go into that building or they're going to be shuttled to their designated school by 7:50. What I'm asking Mr. Spillman to do is based on actual ridership, not every student enrolled in the building or enrolled in the district, based on actual ridership, go backwards from 7:25. Our hope would be that we are starting to pick up between 6:30 to 6:40, 6:45. I want to push the pickup time as late as possible and maximize that time from first point of pickup to 7:25. Does that make sense? Our start times now, our buses, some of our buses are departing our bus garage before 6 a.m. That's why I'm making a decision about delaying or canceling school by 10 after 5. We want to push the entire fleet to start later. How will this affect middle school and high school sporting events, allowing students to get to away games for them to be able to eat, change clothes, etc., and still get there to the game on time for games starting at 4:30? Okay, here's what I was alluding to before. Mrs. Knowles, do you want to speak to that?
I can.
Yeah, here. Come on over.
Thanks. The league that we're moving to, almost all middle school events now will not start till 5 o'clock. So there's no more 4:30 start times for volleyball and basketball, and track is even pushed back. So our kids will still get out of school at 3 o'clock. We won't need to leave here till 3:30, 3:45. There'll be plenty of time for them to eat and change and do their activities they need to do before they leave, because they don't have to be there 45 minutes at 3:45 to play at 4:30. Now they need to be there at 4:15 to play at 5 o'clock. So actually it'll work out fine for our kids. Other than that, they would be sitting around here for a very long time.
Hanging out right here.
and getting bored, waiting on that time for the bus to take them. So this will actually make that more convenient for everyone.
Awesome. Thank you, Mrs. Knowles. Next question is, what time would the building be open to students each day? Great question. So again, there's no difference between the elementary schools and the middle school and high school. Buildings would be open for students to come in beginning at 7:30. Buses will, but here, let me explain that just a little bit. Again, buses coming into each of those home-based locations by 7:25, holding kids to about 7:30. 7:30 is when some kids are going to be coming into the building. At that point, the building principal and the team would be deciding, you know, some kids are going to go into the breakfast area, some kids may be going into the gym at that time and waiting for the bulk of the other students to arrive at 7:50, and then they head into their classrooms. My advice, and we would build a protocol around this, but let me just explain. If you're a parent that says to me right now, Ms. Murphy, still, I'm not going to be riding the bus, my children aren't going to ride the bus, but I'm going to drive them. Okay, great, you're welcome to do that. We will build that process in for you. If you know that buses are going to be in lanes or around the building at about, you know, between 7:25 and then departing at 7:35. Again, at 7:35, now hear me on this and give me tons of grace. If we are going to make this work, I have already instructed Mr. Spillman, our supervisor, and all of our 18 bus drivers. Everybody will be on time and everybody will be consistent. So when the buses arrive at 7:25, they open the doors, students go into the building, students go to another bus to transfer at 7. And you may be arriving, let's say, going back to that example, if you've got multiple children in multiple buildings, and you say, I just want to drive to one building and then my children get on the right bus to go to wherever they need to go, you can do that. But that window is between 7:25 and 7:35. At 7:35, all 16 buses, wherever they are, in four different locations, actually five locations of the district, including New Cumberland, at 7:35, doors will close and buses will leave to their designated school to arrive by 7:50. Okay? So there's a window where you can get your children to pick the building. You can pick the building and get them on that bus by 7:35. Trust me, and you can go see it if you'd like to. Go visit Indian Valley or Claymont in Newcomers Town. It is remarkable to see. It's actually very enjoyable. When you see kindergarten through high school students riding the bus doors open, those kids are getting off all together, and they're together. It's like a family. It's really quite astonishing to see. But at 7:35, those buses will depart and head out. If you're going to dress, you know, let's say you have a middle school child and you're going to drop off your middle school child, I would say please make that happen between 7:35 and 7:45. Children can come right into the building just like they do now. But you want to avoid the 7:50 time because that's when our buses would be coming in to that designated location. Okay? The change in bus route you said was proposed. You're right, I have used the word proposed because the Board of Education has not officially approved anything. The board has been actively engaged in the process. They're aware of the process. They're aware of all of this that we're doing and seeking feedback and working hard on creating the plan. This is not something we've just dreamt up over the last couple of months. This is something we've been working on for a long period of time, but just making sure that all of the environments and everything is just right before we would go forward. When would it be approved? This model, this approach, by going to a district-wide start and end time and eliminating the existing double route system and implementing a single route system for 17-18 school year would likely be, I'm not using the word guaranteed, but it would likely be approved at our April Board of Education meeting as we plan ahead because we want to continue planning and executing well. If you are planning on extra instructional time, what is the quality of the instruction time going to be for young kids getting up an hour earlier? Mrs. Clements or Mrs. Flickinger, any response to that? The quality of the instruction time if we're adding 45 minutes to the day.
I guess I'll take this one. Actually, if you go back and look at some research proves that elementary students actually do much better earlier in the day. And if you have little ones at home, you can usually attest that they're up between 6:30 and 7 o'clock every day anyways. And so you're killing time at home before you can get them on the bus. That is crucial time for us because by the time they get to us at 9 o'clock, they're ready for a snack and a nap. Because they've been up so long. So we are really trying to maximize that time. In our elementary schools, we've also put in some extra curriculum to help with our phonics and reading approach. And that takes up a lot of our day. And we want to make sure that we have enough time to instruct effectively. So we are looking forward to that extra 40 to 45 minutes. Actually, our teachers cheered when they heard they had the extra time in their day. And that it's earlier, because the later we go in the afternoon, it's very hard to keep them on task.
Well, I would just add that, we're thrilled to really have that earlier time. Really right now, like if you are at my building, you're second graders, we do not have specials in the morning in second grade because that is the best instructional time. So we have that ELA block in the morning from the time they get there till they go to recess at 11:10. No specials for second grades in the morning because we know that's their best instructional time. So we are thrilled to have that little bit of extra time. And as she said, the extra curriculum that we added this year, right now, as you add something else has to go. So it certainly gives us the, ability to look at other curriculum and what we're doing with our time. So we're excited.
Thank you, Mrs. Flickinger. And I've got one more here. The question is, what would the building site location be? I really don't know. I have no idea. And again, I've got to give up any kind of the preconceived notions that I've had in the past because I really don't know. I will tell you that we do have, and the board was very thinking forward several years ago when we worked with Mrs. Reed and the board purchased property around this middle school, about 11 acres behind us this direction in the wooded area, and then about 4.5 acres to this direction, a big open field, which we now use for band practice field. Which kind of follows the building site location. I don't know. The next question that falls in alignment with that is, would there be repurposing of the existing structures? And so that's what it says. So my assumption would be this person is thinking about repurposing our existing primary school or intermediate school. When you're partnering with the facility, the Ohio Facilities Construction Commission, and if we're asking them to contribute their 40% of the cost of the project, there are guidelines that need to be followed. For instance, they will not support or co-fund a facility unless it has more than 350 students in that building. And right now, neither one of our schools have more than 350 students. Now we did, but they don't now. And so what does that mean? I don't know. I could speculate a little bit. I think that when you think back to 2008, 2009, when you're looking at a school district that covers 95 square miles or 100 square miles, the center of the school district is right where you are right now. This is the center of our school district. There is property available for renovation, expansion, new, but I don't know what that will look like at this point. But that's one of the reasons that we are asking the Ohio Facilities Construction Commission to begin that active planning process to do a full assessment on all four buildings, as well as the property and the square footage and the enrollment, which then I think leads to a question about enrollment projection and also some more information. I think that was on there, Mr. Phillips. Come on up, Mr. Phillips. This is Mark Phillips. You have Mark and Mark. Mark Phillips is our district treasurer. What is known about our district enrollment projection for the next 10 years? Right now, we know nothing. We know nothing. What we did know is based on when we were looking at facilities projects back in 2008 and 2009, and enrollment projection had already been done for our school district back in 2005. That 10 plus projection, 10 year plus projection, is what I was referring to earlier. And that projection is what said, yep, Mr. Murphy, your Board of Education, you're sitting at about 1,700 students now, but the projection over these next 10 plus years shows a slight decline every single year to about where you're going to be sitting at about where we are right now, a little over 1,400.
Will the Ohio
Facilities Commission, when we say we're entering into the active planning process, which the Board of Education acted on at this last meeting, the Facilities Commission will begin that, and they will make that enrollment projection for the next 10 years. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying that. If enrollment is projected to continue to decrease, is that consistent with projections of other local districts? Just curious. What we are finding, I mean, that's a hard question to answer. I don't want to speak for other districts. Our local city districts are not suffering enrollment decline. The general trend in smaller, more rural, local school districts, they are declining. Is that fair to say? Okay, Mr. Phillips will take the remaining questions then.
Just to add to that, being the treasurer at Fairless and previously being at Strasburg, those districts experienced the same thing, decreases in enrollment. When I was at Strasburg, we built the first phase of the building that they have over there. And DeYoung and Associates was the company that the state hired to do the enrollment projections, and they projected decreases at Strasburg. We didn't believe that those decreases were gonna come. We went down to the state. We sort of fought with the state on those. But in the end, they were right. And if you go to Strasburg now, I mean, just as the enrollment projections were correct here at Tusky Valley, enrollment declined over that 10-year period. My first question, how does the Rover line generate money to Tusky Valley schools? What is taxed? Who pays it? The pipeline pays the tax. And what's taxed is the actual line itself, pumping stations. It's called a public utility personal property tax. And if you see telephone lines, telephone poles, and gas lines currently under the ground are taxed, and we receive money for those public utilities. It says, have you considered the tax revenue from the Utopia line? Utopia is another pipeline that's coming through the school district. It's actually a 12-inch line, and it's pushing liquid through it, some sort of compressed gas. That is not taxable. Pipelines are actually determined whether or not they're taxable based on what's flowing through the line itself. It says, will there be an increased operational levy for the new schools? No. Mark and I actually had a conversation this afternoon. We don't plan to have new levies, hopefully for the remainder of our careers.
Renewals,
obviously, but nothing new. Said, would the Rover pipeline revenue cover all of our 60% local contribution? I don't know. We don't know how much the new facility would cost. We don't know what our share would be, what the state share would be. I think what Mark had in the presentation at the beginning, I will kind of reiterate, is that I don't think we're considering a building project currently if it would create a tax for district residents. The only reason we're starting to look into this or entering into the planning process is because we're hoping that there's enough money that comes in from the pipeline to cover that 60%. Is that a fair statement? How much does the facilities assessment cost? We will pay nothing for this facilities assessment. The state pays for that. It says, if, is that what you hope to use the $100,000 savings for? No.
Talk about how the governor's budget, and how we're trying to, in preparation for that, that's the way we're trying to offset, if that's real. $150,000
in the state.
We're just trying to
streamline. Every 2 years, the state does a biennial budget. Right now, the governor in his proposal has said that he wants to eliminate a part of the funding formula called the guarantee. If that would take place, Tuscarawas Valley Schools would lose about $250,000 a year in state funding. So, like Mark indicated, that $100,000, we would hope would help fill that hole created by that $250,000 cut. I guess I hope I answered the questions. If I didn't, yeah, or yell out something, you can try and answer.
Thank you, Mark. Again, I would just say, as we wrap up, our goal, there is no crystal ball here. There is a lot of unknown, but here's what we are trying desperately to do. Always be ready, be prepared in the event that an opportunity does present itself, that we have positioned ourselves well, and we are ready. Our goal is to not come to any, we are not, we would not be talking about a facilities project, if you will, other than just trying to take care of what we have. We would not be talking about renovations or existing or new or any of those kinds of things if it meant a bond issue. It just would not happen because it's not right and our community can't afford it. There it is. I would feel horrible. There's just no way. There's no way. But if our community could potentially benefit, if our district and our Tuscarawas Valley Trojan country could potentially benefit from the utilities from the Rover pipeline that we could strategically target to be and to serve as the local share of a state project that would be a complete project for our Tuscarawas Valley local schools, we would be crazy, 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 crazy to just keep doing what we've done just because we've always done it that way. That's the best I can say. By restructuring and going to a single system and going to a single start and single end, we prepare ourselves again for the next step. It is one more step in uniting and bringing unity to Tuscarawas Valley Local Schools. It doesn't matter what building I'm in. It doesn't matter what zip code. By the way, 11 zip codes that make up our 95 square miles. It does not matter. We are here to serve the children and the both now and in the future of our children of Tuscarawas Valley. So we want to be ready. The feedback forms, if you wouldn't mind, please, 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 you can leave them on your table, but your feedback is important. You'll notice that there are those three checkboxes, and really, we want to know, number one, I support this district vision. Maybe I don't understand all of it. Maybe I'm still missing some details here, but I support this general vision for what we're after. Box two, I'm a little bit hesitant, but I still support what we're talking about here. Box three, count me out. I understand everything you're sharing, but I still don't support it. We want to know that. You don't have to identify yourself if you don't want to, but we need to know that. And then fill in those blanks if you'd like. If you've got other things you'd like to share or would like to know more about, and if you're saying I'd like to know more about, then I need you to put your name so that I can follow up with you. Okay? But leave those on your tables, and we will stay. And if you've got questions, please come up. Thank you so much for giving your time tonight. Have a great night. Go Trojans.